I don't know if you've noticed, but humans like to categorize things. In French, we have the word genre, which is defined by an ensemble of traits that a group of things have in common. In the context of creative works, the definition also mentions common rules and characteristics. In other words, those characteristics can be consistently found in everything that belongs to that genre. Yet, if we look closely at fighting games as a genre, we quickly realize that despite the obvious similarities, one of its defining characteristics is that fighting games are consistently inconsistent. Just like with genres in literature, TV, cinema, and music, the fighting game genre can be broken down in subgenres. We have traditional 2D fighters, 3D fighters, anime fighters, platform fighters, versus fighters, and arena fighters, to name a few. But that doesn't cleanly split the genre, because not only some of these overlap with one another, but they also don't give you a complete picture of the gameplay either. Strive and GBVS might both be anime fighters, but they play very differently from each other. But there are a few other ways to categorize fighting games that cut across those subgenres, and that the FGC tends to mention only in passing, some of which I think convey important information to someone looking to pick up their first fighting game. So let's look into some of them. One way the FGC likes to compare games is by looking at how much damage individual moves tend to deal relative to the average character's health, aka low damage games and high damage games. In high damage games, your health bar disappears fast, giving characters a sense of power, while in low damage games, the whole match might feel more intense with lots of exchanges, like one of those anime fights that last for 20 episodes. I've heard people saying that high damage games might be better for beginners because the volatility that it comes with makes it easier for players to make a comeback. On the other hand, when you're the one taking that damage, it might exacerbate the feeling of getting utterly destroyed by your opponent and the frustration that might come with it. I will let you draw your own conclusions on which you believe is best and share them in the comment section, but the point is that both kinds exist, and knowing which one a game is might be helpful in making sure you're picking a game that suits your preferences. Another way to classify a fighting game is by how many full combos, or touches, it usually takes to defeat your opponent. A lower number means the game focuses more on combo execution, while a higher number means a bigger focus on spacing, pattern recognition, and mind games. It's another compromise which has no right answers in terms of what a beginner should be seeking. A many-touch game will give you more opportunities to break through your opponent's defense and land that first hit that can lead into a combo, but it will also give you more opportunities to get clapped on wake-up, which in my opinion isn't necessarily a bad thing, because that's also a situation you'll need to learn how to handle. But I can see how that can be frustrating when you just keep guessing the mix-up wrong. On the flip side, a few-touch game means there are fewer interactions for you to lose, but it will often feel like playing rock, paper, scissors, except the rock, paper, and scissors are replaced with sequences of ninjutsu hand signs if the game has long combos. On that note, although damage output and touch count sound similar, they are different parameters, the combination of which leads to very different game experiences. Essentially, a two-touch game with low damage is going to have longer combos than a five-touch game with high damage. And without combo breaker mechanics, long combos mean longer periods of time where the defender is not really playing the game. I am not saying that long combos should or shouldn't exist. It's a pointless conversation when we're discussing existing games. And I understand that it's frustrating when the game you like the look of doesn't have the gameplay that works for you. But as Sejam said, you have to play the game as it is, not as you wish it was, or not playing at all, I might add. What's important is to be aware that games do differ in that aspect, and I think not knowing this is a big reason why some people trying to get into fighting games get put off, because they picked a game that's not for them. I don't know how many times I've heard people complaining about getting juggled for 10 seconds, only to admit that they've only tried a game that's notorious for having touch of death combos. At the risk of stating the obvious, it's worth pointing out that the actual number of touches required changes depending on the level of play, as well as the player base's experience with the game. Pro level First Strike might be a two-touch game, at least for some characters, but it might be more like 6 or 7 touches at the beginner level. Or some games might be considered four-touch until someone finds some tech or exploit that lets them do an infinite combo. So, while the developers usually have an idea of what they're going for, it's ultimately the community who's got a better idea of how a game rates on those scales, so you'd need to ask around what a game is like, or maybe check the wikis if you have that information. There's one more way to categorize games that's less open to interpretation, and which is where the genre's inconsistency is most apparent. With a few notable exceptions, pretty much every fighting game will have more than one button dedicated to primary attacks. How many? It depends. It ranges anywhere from 1 to 6 buttons, with 4 and 6 being the most common configurations. It's important to note that the number of buttons a game uses is not necessarily an indicator of how complex it is, as some might have the same button do different things depending on context, such as proximity to the enemy, or some games might ask you to press several buttons for some attacks, which, to be honest, pretty much all games do, but those with fewer buttons have a tendency to rely on it more. For instance, I feel much more comfortable with Street Fighter's 6 buttons than Soul Calibur's 3. But even games that use the same number of buttons might be very different. Let's look at 4-button games, for instance. Usually, you'll either have a light, medium, heavy attack plus something else, or you'll have 2 punches and 2 kicks split in different ways. Some games will have a light and heavy split. Mortal Kombat goes front side, back side, and Tekken goes left side, right side, which kind of loses all meaning when you have to press several buttons at once. And put your pitchforks down. I am not saying that fighting games need to standardize, but we have to recognize that it contributes to the other big inconsistency issue in fighting games, which is that universal concepts don't have universal controls. For instance, blocking incoming attacks is done in some games by holding back, in others by pressing a dedicated guard button, or in other games by doing nothing. And which attack each type of block is effective against changes between 2D and 3D games. There are understood conventions, such as quarter circle forwards plus some button will usually launch some kind of projectile, or that the dragon punch motion is dedicated for a reversal anti-air attack. But that's not a guarantee. Just like the Pirate Code, it's more guidelines than rules. Even within the same game or game series, some fundamental actions are not always consistent. In Street Fighter, crouching heavy kick always causes a knockdown, except when it doesn't. In Strive, airborne attacks require a standing block, except when they don't. I can already see you typing something about how this is for the sake of making characters feel different, and of course, it is important to have a wide variety of characters with different playstyles and depth of gameplay, because you can only make so many variations of your standard karateka. Capcom tried. Hard. But I don't believe that inconsistent controls are necessary to achieve that. Character-specific mechanics, visual design, animations, and frame data are good ways of achieving that uniqueness. DNF Duel has a mostly standardized command list while still retaining varied characters, for the most part. But in fairness, it's not that big of a deal, and it doesn't take that much time getting used to, but it does take some time getting used to when switching from one game to another or one character to another. Especially when you compare it to, say, first-person shooters, which have had the fire, aim, reload, crouch, etc. controls roughly in the same places for decades now across pretty much all games. And as I said earlier though, existing games are what they are, and this inconsistency isn't going to get patched out, nor am I suggesting it should be. Although I think it's still important to point these things out, to start a discussion on where the genre should be headed in order to reach its full potential. But I started this channel in the hope of getting more people into fighting games now, not in 3 years. So why am I even talking about this? Well, as mentioned at the beginning of the video, as things currently stand, this is a defining characteristic of the genre, for better and worse. So if you're going to get in on the action, you have to know this is a thing and accept it. It's undeniable that this inconsistency has downsides. For instance, the time you've invested in learning a character doesn't transfer as easily if you want to try a new one. Or even if you're experienced in fighting games, picking up a new game usually means being a beginner again, even if some skills will transfer, so it's not easy to be as good as every fighting game you play. And that contributes to fragmenting a player base that's already small, as some people might stick to the one game they're most skilled at because they don't want to start at the bottom in a new game. But this inconsistency also has benefits, the biggest of which is that you have an incredible diversity of games to play, providing very different experiences, and you know I've been making a point of showing that to you in my videos. It also teaches you not to take anything for granted. because even if everything was the same, you'd still have the variable of your opponent. So you have to learn to adapt to new information and unexpected behavior. And despite those skill transfer and fragmentation issues, many FGC members do play multiple games concurrently, which I feel is much less frequent in other competitive games. Back when I played War Thunder, I wasn't also playing World of Tanks. When I played Bad Company 2, I wasn't playing Call of Duty. And when I played True Combat Elite, I wasn't playing Counter-Strike. But here I am splitting my time between Strive, GBVS, DNF Duel, Street Fighter V, and Third Strike. Not because a single game isn't enough to keep me engaged, but because there are so many of them that are appealing in their own way that I've got to play them all. So embrace the chaos and come play some fighting games. Hello, it's me again for a super quick post-video update. First of all, thanks for the almost 1500 subs with only two videos. I really appreciate it. And as I mentioned last time, the next video will kick off the tutorial series, but I think I'll alternate between tutorials and video essays for variety and also for my sanity. I should probably take the time to plug my Twitter account, which I've recently rebooted, where I might post some more stuff and ask you all for opinions. See you then!